Seth Carpenter was dreaming despite the repeated sound of the answering machine clicking on. He was aware in between dreams that the messages were long. Seth had awakened earlier at 4 a.m., still on New York time from his 2 weeks in Manhattan. Before returning to bed next to Andy, Seth ate a yogurt and made coffee. He watched the sunrise above the bay, illuminating the rainbow flag, the Transamerica Pyramid, Berkeley in the distance and Mount Diablo. His caffeinated dream about Meryl Streep was interrupted by Andy throwing open the bedroom door and shouting with a scary urgency, "Seth, get up! Get up!" Seth followed Andy to their living room. NPR and Katie Couric were both on. There was fire coming from the World Trade Center. Seth could see a gaping hole and hear NPR say explosion. Andy said, "Some people say they saw a plane fly into it." The always perky Couric looked confused. NPR reporters sounded flustered. Seth said somehow, sensing there was something terribly wrong, "I hope this was an accident." He remembered when the car bomb went off at the World Trade Center's garage when he was living with roommates on Hayes Street before he met Andy. Seth was transfixed to the television when an explosion erupted from World Trade Center 2. Andy shouted, "Those fuckers!" (clears throat) 6:03 a.m. Seth knew there was a shift, an uninvited guest, that had been kept at the door, was now loose. He thought about Israel and how getting on a plane or bus was supposed to be scary there. His now annual late summer trip to New York had just ended, one of Seth's best New York trips ever. It had been the summer of the Seagull in Central Park with Meryl Streep and Seymour Hoffman. He looked away from the flames and onto the dining room table, still piled high with purchases from the Chelsea flea market, ornate Afghani wood blocks, a large panel of chintz fabric, antique botanical prints, and used books. He remembered the perfect weather, comfortable guest rooms in friends' apartments, lazy days on Fire Island, and the incredible theater. What was on television was all too real, and now he could feel the unwanted guest, the open casket image never to be erased. Each tower crumbled, a plane crash in Pennsylvania, the Pentagon burning. Andy and Seth didn't speak. Both were sobbing and watching clouds of carnage chase people running through concrete canyons. Images he knew he'd never forget. An awakened awareness, a new palpable fear. Seth's mind raced with American moments. The space shuttle exploding. Firehouse hoses and dogs turned on civil rights workers. John saluting his father. Pearl Harbor burning in black and white. The strange sense he had when the radio played one John Lennon song after another while he did his homework. Jacqueline Kennedy dressed in vibrant pink, crawling across, reaching for the Secret Service agent, reaching for a profile in Courage forever altered, reaching for the moment before. In the coming days, the television kept showing images of people running in Manhattan, running with their mouths covered, barefoot, terrified. In the coming days, when no planes flew above San Francisco, the images of terrified New Yorkers running stayed with Seth the most. That and the picture online of a woman's dusty shoe abandoned next to a fruit stand, left with its ash-covered cash box open and untouched. The messages on the answering machine were from family and friends who thought Seth was still in Manhattan. The television would remain on for days until bedtime for sleep that seldom came. Images on a loop of men running with their ties flapping over their shoulders, bikes and pushcarts enveloped, and finally the sound of debris hitting the microphones. One man saying calmly, "I hope I live," before his camera would go dark with heavy gray blinding debris, a horrific blizzard. Always the shots of the carnage cloud at an intersection, turning and chasing office workers, running, running. The world had forever changed since sunrise. Seth felt an undirected anger as he swept the kitchen. His memory reached back to his first visit to New York City when he was 15. The whisk broom's handle, not quite pink, not quite red, was flecked with the tapioca-colored paint the California carpenters used to paint their dining room. Now, this household item seemed out of place in 1979 upstate New York, sweeping the inside of the VW pop-top camper with each stroke. Seth tried to time his sobbing so he wouldn't be heard. It was at this campground following a visit to the military academy at West Point where Seth's hopes for his first long-awaited visit to New York City were whisked away when his father said, "Boys, we've spent too much money on hotels, so we'll have to drive straight through New York and camp in Williamsburg, Virginia." Seth grabbed the small plastic broom and threw it at nothing in particular. It bounced off a tree that didn't grow in Southern California. A dogwood? A Norfolk Island pine? Attempting to identify the tree momentarily swept away Seth's despair at Broadway lost, Kate not seen, Central Park not walked, museums not visited, the kicks of a chorus line not witnessed. His entire enthusiasm washed clean, swept away. His whole life seemed pointless as sweeping the inside of a van, which would now only get dirty again in fucking quaint colonial Williamsburg. "Seth, honey, we just can't afford it. We had no plans on spending so much money on hotels in the Midwest." Seth's mother knew the importance Seth had placed on the city ever since she took him to see Fame. Seth apologized about throwing the broom and momentarily considered offering to forgo his allowance in order to pay for just one night in New York City. But how long would it take $5 a week to pay for the dream that he no longer had a handle on? The next day, Seth pressed his face against the backseat window as the van moved too quickly down Fifth Avenue. Central Park was to the right, and elegant buildings with awnings were on the left. Doormen with gold buttons and hats, well-dressed Upper East Side residents returning from their day in the most exciting place on earth. All Seth would get was a view from the back seat. It was the first time he hadn't wanted to utilize his learner's permit on the entire trip. The driving, the clouds of New Mexico, the seeing real non-Disneyland fireflies had just been highlights of the journey so far. But for Seth, this was all just a preview to experiencing New York City, the city that never sleeps. He hoped for traffic so he could see Jacqueline Kennedy at 1045 Fifth Avenue. 1045th came and went with no Jackie sighting, just a doorman sweeping the entry. The humidity made the faces on the gray facade of Mrs. Kennedy's building appear as though they were weeping, which made Seth feel somehow better. The tan van slowly continued down Fifth Avenue, Seth taking it all in. As the van approached the ferry, Seth actually considered jumping off the ferry into the water and swimming onto the island of Manhattan, the island of his dreams. He was a strong swimmer. Surely Mrs. Kennedy would give him a towel and some of John John's old Brooks Brothers clothes. She was known for her graciousness and charm. They'd become friends. He'd find Katharine Hepburn and ride bikes with her through the city. He would call her Kate. Andy Warhol would teach him how to silkscreen famous celebrities. But as the van and ferry moved farther away, Seth felt not sadness, but resolve. He knew he'd be back. He knew he'd someday have friends in New York who had awnings and a view of the park, with doormen sweeping the entry for Seth's return. Seth Carpenter, now angrily sweeping his San Francisco kitchen, remembered one of his first adult trips to New York City. He remembers sitting in a bar on the Upper East Side of Manhattan called The Link. He was now 24 and had visited New York at least four times since he first zoomed down Fifth Avenue with his family 9 years prior. He was staying with his friend Tim Williams on the Upper West Side, who told him where Katharine Hepburn lived, and near the United Nations. Stephen Sondheim was her next-door neighbor. Seth had spent the morning sitting on the stoop across from Kate's gated brownstone. All he wanted was a glimpse of his icon. Sondheim would be a consolation prize, and according to Tim, the genius Broadway composer would probably invite him into his house to get high. Apparently, this was a common ploy the composer used to woo young gay men attempting to see his famous neighbor. The morning had been unsuccessful thus far, and Seth waited on the stoop, leaving only briefly to purchase an authentic New York-style slice of pizza and use the restroom. While sitting on the increasingly hot stoop in Turtle Bay, the toniest of New York neighborhoods, Seth felt like a naturalist or a zoologist trying to be nondescript while trying to catch a glimpse of a rare, reclusive bird. When a woman suddenly appeared on a bicycle and zoomed past Seth, he was sure it was Hepburn. He couldn't see her face behind a large straw hat and upturned white collar over a red turtleneck. The woman was wearing black slacks and wore leather sandals. Seth assured himself he had accomplished his goal, and though he couldn't be certain in his mind going forward, he was now assured that he'd seen Katharine Hepburn. He now actually hoped Mr. Sondheim, the consolation prize, would invite him inside to get high. As Seth made his way back toward Central Park, back to Tim's, he walked on East 56th Street and instantly became aware of all the rainbow flags and gay porn and leather shops. It was 3:30 on Wednesday, and Jeff and Seth felt like a beer. He saw one subterranean bar flapping below a flapping rainbow flag. He was surprised when he was greeted at the entrance by a bouncer who asked for a $10 cover. Though he was shocked, Seth thought this was a New York thing and handed over the cover charge and headed into the bar. Sam, the impossibly handsome bartender, listened intently to Seth's history with New York, his tale of the morning trying to see Hepburn. Sam beginning to comp Seth's beer, Seth becoming buzz, when a well-dressed man in a Perry Ellis suit tapped him on the shoulder, introduced himself, and asked Seth, "Are you working?" "No, I'm on vacation," Seth replied and continued to talk to Sam. A half hour later, he and Sam were talking Broadway and movie trivia. Seth was asked again, "Are you working?" Another well-dressed man in his 50s who looked like Richard Chamberlain had sat next to Seth's bar stool and seemed dejected when Seth answered honestly, "No, I'm on vacation." It was then that Seth looked around the bar and realized that everyone in the now increasingly crowded bar was in their 20s. And the pages stick together. Was in their 20s or 50s and older. Seth and Sam were the best-looking young men in the bar, and Seth turned to Sam and somewhat knowingly asked, "These guys think I'm a prostitute, don't they? Wow, you're really from California, aren't you? I thought this was your shtick." Sam continued, "Yes, all the men drooling behind you think you are working." Both young men laughed at Seth's genuine naivete, and Sam continued to give Seth free drinks. Slightly woozy, Seth looked out the small window and could see the $10 doorman sweeping the entrance. He found one of the men attractive and wondered how much he was worth, a passing thought. Tim couldn't believe Seth had never heard of the Link, apparently a notorious hustler bar. 2 years later, Seth flew to New York for a long weekend to attend his cousin's wedding at the Mercer Hotel. He defiantly decided not to stay at the posh Mercer, but at a friend from college parent's apartment on Riverside Drive. Seth had heard the Thompsons were radical activists. Upon his arrival at their third floor walk-up in a clean but decidedly grotty building, Seth was met by Mrs. Thompson. She was wearing a denim overall dress, her brown hair piled into a loose bun. "Chris has told us so much about you. We're so pleased you can stay here," she exclaimed while embracing Seth in a fleshy hug smelling vaguely of pot. "I hope you can join us for the Biko Liz Festival party tomorrow. We've organized for tomorrow night." Seth agreed immediately. He'd been involved in anti-apartheid groups since Birmingham High. The next day, Seth saw a matinee performance of Orpheus Descending with Vanessa Redgrave on Broadway. Seth wore his Perry topsiders, pink Lacoste shirt, and Bermuda shorts. After the show, Seth followed Mrs. Thompson's subway directions to the festival exactly. Upon exiting the subway station, Seth realized he was in Harlem, and it was becoming darker and darker. He was unable to see the World Trade Center and suddenly realized he was walking very fast. Mrs. Thompson's directions weren't matching up with any of the streets in view. Harlem in the late 1980s, before cell phones, before Giuliani, before September 11th. Seth felt the large Nikon camera around his neck and the $100 bill his Aunt Helen had given him were screaming, "Steal me." Seth was the only white person around, and his internal monologue was, "Am I a racist or am I informed?" Was he a preppy in peril? He walked faster and faster, holding his large camera to his chest. There were no payphones or taxis to be found. He wanted to tell everyone he was going to a Biko Lives festival. He couldn't get Vanessa Redgrave's performance out of his mind. When her character, Mrs. Torrance, was fatally shot, Vanessa Redgrave slumped to the floor and locked eyes with Seth for the final 10 minutes of the play. Seth wondered if this was to be his final 10 minutes on Earth, getting shot and dying with his eyes open like Vanessa. He didn't want to be afraid, but the heavy camera was now bouncing against his chest so hard it began to hurt. An elderly black woman sitting resplendently on her stoop, wearing a pink house coat with her hair and matching pink curlers, was smoking a long, thin cigarette. She exhaled smoke and laughed while yelling at Seth, "Look at the white boy run!" Now, finished with the kitchen cleaning, he looked in the dining room table piled high with his flea market finds. Seth had been to New York many times by now, at least 20 visits since his first visit. He did have friends with doormen and guest rooms. He could find his way around the city easily and was happy on his last trip to take the Thompsons out for dinner. At dinner, Mrs. Thompson's ongoing apology for giving Seth incorrect directions to the Biko Liz Festival continued. I'll never forgive myself, she continued to say, despite Seth's assurances that he'd survived with a great, albeit scary, story. The story, the fear, the time now just amused Seth in this era of small digital cameras and cell phones. Apartheid was over, Harlem was safe, Mrs. Kennedy and Katharine Hepburn and Warhol were all dead. But just as he knew when he was 15, Seth Carpenter now treated New York City as his home away from home. A few weeks later, after every nook in Andy and Seth's apartment had been cleaned, when planes began to fly again, Seth took the advice of the president he despised. He was on nearly the first available plane to return to New York City. He felt patriotic and somehow happy to be channeling his anger into a trip to New York. When Bush said, come to New York, shop. Broadway still needs to fill seats. Seth knew it was his duty to travel and patronize. Seth went to the site of the World Trade Center, remember seeing them for the first time from the back of the VW van. They were the last piece of New York architecture the Carpenter saw looming in the distance as the ferry pulled away all those years ago. Now the monument stripped from view. Now the void more powerful than the solid. Not just the pit, the open, pungent mass grave, but throughout the entire city, the anchor Seth had always used to determine which way was south when the concrete canyons was gone, when inside the concrete canyons were now gone. Yet on this trip, Seth attended four plays, two exhibits, and took all his New York City friends out for dinner. Fuck Al-Qaeda was the common toast that week, so close to the attacks. 2 years later, in 2003, Seth happened to win a round-trip ticket on a new airline. Of course he chose to travel to New York and stay with friends on the Upper West Side. He really wanted to see Doubt with Broadway legend Cherry Jones. But it had been 2 years of war, the Patriot Act, and more brutal crimes against gays. 2 years of W and Laura, who was singly bringing back the peplum to women's skirts. This first lady was the anti-Jacqueline Kennedy. The Bushes never held state dinners, and their day class 8 approach to just about everything was becoming predictable, upsetting, and scary. This was not Camelot. An hour after boarding the flight to New York, Seth was watching North by Northwest when he noticed every other passenger's screen was tuned to CNN. Anderson Cooper was looking urgently into the camera with shots of Manhattan behind his gaze with the camera. That's when Seth saw the headline, credible evidence of imminent attack on New York City. Seth tuned in to Anderson, who was telling of credible evidence to suggest Al-Qaeda was planning on exploding baby strollers in the city subways. Locked in a metal tube, flying towards New York danger, Seth was mad, scared, and pissed off for being scared and mad. His initial enthusiasm to return to New York was free. To return to New York for free was nearly instantly swept away. Landing at JFK that night was like what Seth, though he'd never been imagined, like was like landing in Israel. SWAT teams, all in black, were strolling up and down throughout the airport, brandishing automatic weapons. This was both alarming and reassuring. There were no cabs. This was a credible threat. No one wanted to take the subway. The next day, Senator Schumer was pictured in front of the New York Times, seated in a subway car. The photograph was in color, and the senator, who Seth had always admired, looked frightened, stoic, and uncomfortable. This image was meant to calm the nerves of already frazzled New Yorkers. Seth was terrorized, and the constant October rain lent itself to staying in one place. He'd got food poisoning from some bad Chinese and couldn't stop vomiting. He was, however, determined to see Doubt. He could redeem his fear and anger, if not his stomach, if he made it to one cultural event on this trip. The play was transcendent. The rain was pouring so hard the audience in back wondered if the drops landing on Cherry Jones's character, a nun, were planned. The opening dialogues resonated with the playgoers. Sometimes doubt is the only form of certainty we have. It was this line that emboldened Seth to take the subway. Following the performance, taxis remained almost impossible to get with the rain and the crowded fear in Times Square. His bravery lasted only momentarily when Seth went below street level to take the subway. He saw three baby strollers within minutes. Everyone looked suspicious. Seth obviously looked agitated since he went out of his way to stay away from women and men pushing baby strollers. "Hey man, you've got nothing to be afraid of," someone yelled at him as he was clearly avoiding anyone he could. The trains weren't following any normal schedules or stopping at regular intervals. This municipal homeland security measure only ensured more humanity crowded onto the subway platform, soaked, scared, and mad. Seth didn't want to be afraid of baby strollers, of children and parents, of subways, of the city he loved. The next day, after a sleepless night, Seth was back at JFK. He realized he still had most of his cash left. He kept his back to the pillar at the boarding gate, avoiding passengers with strollers or those who looked vaguely Middle Eastern. When his flight was called, he heard her. Inside his head, he heard her. She was reaching out through time, laughing at him again, reaching, yelling, "Look at the white boy run."